Welcome you all. Good evening, everybody. And as you know, that the topic today is a very important topic of organ transplantation, which epitomizes the research and experience in the medical science, which is and it's mainly responsible is because of the advances in anesthesia and critical care, and also in immunosuppressive therapy, in addition to the technical advances. But multidisciplinary approach is required to have this good success rate. And for this, we must learn each and every point. Today, we are starting our discussion with the renal transplant. And the speaker is, can you start the first slide, please? Is Professor Rashmi Jain from Gangaram Hospital. She is a very intelligent, very hardworking anesthetist. I have seen her personally during my stay there, and she will be presenting with the renal transplantation, what are the precautions to be taken and how to start and have best result. Dr. Rashmi Jain, please start.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everybody. I want to take this opportunity to thank ICA, my teachers and mentors. As we all know, the normal glomerular filtration rate is 90 ml per minute per meter square. When there is an insidious fall in GFR over a period of 3 months or more, it is reversible. And with or without markers of kidney damage being present, then we call it end-stage renal disease. The treatment for it is either dialysis or kidney transplant. We also know that kidney transplant is the preferred treatment for end-stage renal disease because it prolongs life and the overall cost of treatment is less with kidney transplant as compared to dialysis. So what are the principles of anesthesia for renal transplant? First of all is to keep the patient warm and well perfused. We have to maintain adequate mean arterial pressure. That is, we have to be very meticulous to prevent hypovolemia and hypotension by optimizing the fluid status. The most often asked question these days in this pandemic is, should we at all be doing the renal transplant, for that matter, any transplant, because these patients are immunosuppressed. They have multiple visits to the hospital and come face to face with the healthcare workers. So the chances of infection is very high. And once infected, they continue to shed virus for a longer duration. In our hospital, we have continued to do renal transplant and kept all the precautions and safeguards. We have screened the donor and recipients for COVID infection. And if we see that the donor is exposed to a suspected COVID patient in the last 28 days, then the surgery is deferred. According to the American Transplant Society, they had issued a guideline that elective transplants should be deferred in communities where spread of COVID is high. This is to minimize the risk of infection and conserve hospital resources. The most common cause of end-stage renal disease is diabetes and hypertension, as you can see in this graph, which I have taken from Miller 2020 edition. Besides that, glomerulonephritis, cystic kidney disease, and other causes of end-stage renal disease. These patients have multitude of comorbidities, so the pre-transplant screening becomes very important. We have to screen for viral and bacterial infection and assess for cardiac disease, hypertension, peripheral artery disease. The cardiovascular disease is the highest cause of morbidity and mortality. Besides that, diabetes and coagulopathies, malignancy should also be screened. Pre-operatively, patient counseling is important. Besides that, we have to do blood grouping and HLA typing to see if the donor and the recipient organs match. Other than that, we have to treat any hyperkalemia and acid-base disturbances. We have to develop an individualized and tailored perioperative therapy, avoid any potential nephrotoxic drugs. The most important contraindications is active malignancy and infection. Besides this, there are certain rare renal diseases which can cause graft loss, and these patients should be selected for transplant with caution, like light chain deposit disease, primary oxalosis, and antiglomerular basement membrane antibodies. The pre-medication has to be individualized for each patient. Diabetes and hypertension should be controlled preoperatively. The European Society of Anesthesia, they said that CKD is a risk factor for cardiac complication, which we know for sure. So besides the routine monitoring and investigations, we have to do a 12-lead ECG, echocardiography, and a stress, dobutamine stress echocardiography. A low-dose beta blocker therapy can be instituted 1 week before surgery. In my experience, what I've seen is these patients normally come for surgery with at least 3 or 4 antihypertensive drugs. And in spite of that, almost 50 to 70% patients experience marked swings in blood pressure during intubation, incision, and extubation. However, if the arterial pressure is consistently elevated more than 180 by 110 millimeters of mercury during induction of anesthesia, we may proceed, but care should be taken to ensure cardiovascular stability. To treat intraoperative hypertension, intravenous nitroglycerin is the drug that is routinely used. Sublingual nifedipine should not be used because it reduces splanchnic blood flow and consequently increases morbidity and mortality. If the patient preoperatively is on ARB, angiotensin receptor blockers, then they may be stopped because it can lead to hypotension at the time of induction and perioperatively. The other drugs may be continued. This is the Frank-Starling curve. Here, it is seen that when we give intravenous fluids, then the left ventricular end diastolic pressure increases and consequently the cardiac output also increases. However, in patients with poor myocardial function, they are at risk of fluid overload, acute pulmonary edema, acute respiratory failure, and prolonged intubation. So it is a double-edged sword, especially in patients who come with cardiomyopathies, to load them with intravenous fluids or not. The other problem that we face is anemia. This is because they have decreased erythropoietin synthesis and release. There is reduced red blood cell lifespan, increased hemolysis and bleeding. There is repeated blood loss during hemodialysis. Uremia-induced bone marrow suppression. There is iron folate, vitamin B6, and B12 deficiency. However, in recent times, the problem of anemia has been mitigated because of availability of recombinant erythropoietin. So initially, when we used to see patients coming with hemoglobin as low as 4 to 5 gram percent, which used to affect the renal perfusion and the outcome of the transplant, nowadays, patients come with good hemoglobin of 8 to 9, 10 gram percent, and our results are better. Another problem is coagulopathy because the platelet adhesion and aggregation is reduced. However, PT and APTT is normal. There is platelet consumption in the dialyzer, which increases the risk of bleeding. So thromboelastography, which is a point of care coagulation monitor, comes in handy. This is the graph shown in the picture. We get patients from hilly areas which come with platelet count as low as 50,000. But when we run their sample in the thromboelastography, the platelet function is found to be normal. And we go ahead with the surgery without any problem. So it's a good monitor to have. All these problems can potentially increase the blood loss. However, in our experience, the blood loss is less and the patients rarely require blood transfusion. according to the kidney clinical practice guidelines 2012, blood transfusion is usually not recommended unless there is acute blood loss during reperfusion. This is because the blood transfusion is like transfusing or transplanting another organ. It causes immunomodulation and shift in the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. If at all we need to give blood, then leukocyte depleted packed cells should be given. Blood transfusion does not improve transplantation outcome. During the preoperative preparation, the acid-base status should be looked into and it should be corrected. The electrolyte disturbances have largely disappeared due to routine dialysis before transplantation. We do dialysis a day before surgery. Hyperkalemia can also be corrected by giving glucose insulin therapy. It causes intracellular shift of potassium, soda bicarb, cardiac membrane stabilization with calcium chloride, and cation exchange resins and renal replacement therapy during dialysis. This is the picture of our patient undergoing dialysis in the unit. So any disturbance in the electrolyte is largely unknown now. However, it causes fluid depletion and residual anticoagulation is present. For the perioperative management, we can choose either regional anesthesia or general anesthesia, but the most popular worldwide is to give general anesthesia, which includes paralysis and controlled ventilation. So what is the disadvantage of regional anesthesia? This is because CVP and arterial lines have to be inserted in an awake patient. There is difficulty in handling major blood loss in a vasodilated patient. These patients have coagulopathies and the risk of extradural hematoma is high. There is also medico-legal implication of post-operative peripheral neuropathy, especially in diabetic patients. And it's a long procedure, so a awake patient may get restless. Perioperative management has to be individualized. So besides the routine monitor, we put a central venous cannulation. It helps to guide fluid therapy. It has to be done in absolutely aseptic precautions because these patients are immunosuppressed. We like to maintain a high CVP at the time of reperfusion. Vascular access post-operatively is very good because of this. Then the patient can, we can avoid multiple intravenous lines post-operatively. And we can do repeated sampling from central venous cannula. An intra-arterial line is inserted intraoperatively after anesthesia is induced. The arterial line has to be inserted on the side opposite to where the AV fistula is present. Core temperature monitoring is done by using thermal blankets. For the pharmacological management, we have to avoid NSAIDs preoperatively, perioperatively as well. Induction of anesthesia can be done with propofol or thiopentone sodium. We have to titrate the doses because these patients are volume constricted because they lose fluid during hemodialysis and they are on 3 or 4 antihypertensive drugs. So they can have precipitous fall in blood pressure at the time of induction. Opioids should be used during anesthesia at the time of induction. Again, titrated doses, fentanyl or morphine can be used. This is because if we don't take care of pain, then there is a neurohormonal response and intense vasoconstriction can happen because of pain, which can cause delayed graft function. Volatile anesthetics are good agents because they help us to control blood pressure and also prevent any ischemia reperfusion injury that might occur. The muscle relaxants of choice are sesatracurium and atracurium. Both of these drugs and the reversal agents get excreted out from the graft kidney at the same rate as the native kidneys. So there is no problem. This is a picture showing AV fistula. It requires special care during positioning for surgery and is always made in the non-dominant arm in our institution. BP cuff should not be placed in this arm and no intravenous cannulation. Central venous cannulation should also be not done on this arm, even if you are doing an intrajugular vein cannulation, because there is arterialization of the veins and the pressures are not accurate. AVG, the point of care monitor, is very good to have because we can instantly know what if the patient is acidotic and control it by giving sodium bicarbonate. Fluid therapy is the most important aspect of renal transplant. Traditionally, world over, we are using normal saline. However, now the reports are coming that it causes hypokalemia, which is very difficult to understand because it is the only fluid that does not contain potassium. All the other fluids have potassium in them. It is because it causes extracellular shift of potassium due to acute changes in blood H-ion concentration, which occurs with hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Normal saline has a very high chloride concentration of 154 milliequivalents per liter. This concept was very well explained in the last ICA webinar, which was on intravenous fluids. So what should we do? What other fluids that are available which we can use safely? So in this article published in 2008, RCT, which compared isotonic saline, ringer lactate, and balanced crystalloids, the effect of different crystalloid solutions on acid-base balance and early kidney function after kidney transplantation. And they found that all the three fluids are safe to give. Isotonic saline in almost 16% of the patient caused acidosis. Lactic acid raised in ringer lactate group. However, balanced crystalloids were found to be the most suitable. We must also keep in mind that large volumes of fluids are given, so they should be warmed before administration. This is another RCT which came out in 2010. The impact of timing of maximal crystalloid hydration on early graft function during kidney transplantation. So in this, they made two groups, one where a continuous infusion was given right from the start of the anesthesia, and in another group, CVP-guided infusion was given at the time of anastomosis of the graft kidney. So it was found that where an acute rise of CVP was done in a limited time, that is, we give aggressive fluids for about half an hour to 45 minutes, it was found that the patient was more stable and the graft function was better. What is the role of colloids in renal transplant patients? Human albumin, it improves the short-term and long-term outcome in renal transplant surgery. So we can give 20% albumin, which is the one which is available with us, 0.8 to 1.6 ml per kg, and it has been seen to improve graft survival. Artificial colloids such as gelatin, dextrans, and hydroxyethyl starches are unsuitable and should not be given. They cause anaphylactic reaction, bleeding complications, and reticuloendothelial system dysfunction. The other measures that we take to improve urine output is mannitol. It improves the diuresis by increasing concentration of filtrates in the kidney and also causes intracellular release of prostaglandins. It blocks the reabsorption of water from renal tubules. It scavenges the free radicals and can be given in doses of 0.25 to 0.5 grams per kg. Loop diuretics are also useful. They inhibit sodium potassium ATPase, decreasing the tubular oxygen consumption, which offers some protection against ischemic injury. We are using 100 milligram bolus dose prior to reperfusion. However, textbook says that you can go up to 500 milligram, but one has to be careful because there are very serious side effects with furosemide. And we have got good results with 100 milligram bolus dose. This strategy is, however, based only on observational study. Sodium bicarbonate is very useful to correct acidosis. We do 100% correction. It restores the effectiveness of exogenous catecholamines and vascular tone, and should be given slowly to avoid overproduction of CO2 because it causes intracellular acidosis. This statement is supported if you read this article in Anesthesia and Analgesia 2005. So in spite of taking all the precaution, what do we do if there is delayed graft function? Delayed graft function means that there is no immediate Ritz perfuse diuresis post reperfusion, and the patient requires dialysis in first week after transplantation. This can happen if there is hypovolemia or hypotension at the time of reperfusion, which can happen because either there is acute blood loss, which is a surgical problem. However, if we have not given fluids aggressively, or if the PP has suddenly dropped, because we must remember that at the time of reperfusion, we are adding about 300 ml of intravascular space. So we have to either reduce the dose of volatile anesthetics, or we have to make sure that the patient is euvolemic during reperfusion. The other causes of delayed graft function are increased cold ischemia time. Especially this is what happens in diseased donor transplant, which Dr. Rashmi Datta is going to talk subsequently. So if there is increased cold ischemia time, which is the most important factor contributing to delayed graft function. The other reasons may be if the patient has been on dialysis for a long time, or if we are using vasoactive drugs intraoperatively, because it also causes renal vasoconstriction. Nowadays, to increase the donor pool, extended criteria kidney donors are accepted. Like if the age of the patient is more than 60 years, if there is hypertension, or if serum creatinine is more than 1.5 milligram per cent, or if patient has low GFR, or if hemorrhagic stroke is the cause of death. So if we are taking a suboptimal graft from the cadaver, then that also can lead to delayed graft function. Besides, it has been seen that hemodialysis in the immediate period before transplantation is associated with poor outcome. This is because of complement activation by the dialysis membrane and intravascular hypovolemia. Patients on hemodialysis are hypovolemic, volume contracted, as compared to patients on peritoneal dialysis who present with better volume status. Blood sugar levels should be meticulously controlled. They also can affect the graft function during reperfusion. Insulin should be given perioperatively if the sugar levels go above 180, although I try to give insulin only when it is above 200 milligram per cent, because one has to be also watching against hypoglycemia. Most of the patients can be extubated on the table. Once there is graft function and adequate urine output, the most of the drugs that we have given get washed out, and the patient is able to breathe spontaneously after giving reversal agent. For post-operative analgesia, a functioning graft, it itself contributes to effective analgesia. Besides that, we can give morphine or paracetamol. Patient-controlled analgesia is also a good choice. There have been recent articles which say transversus abdominis plain block can be given to these patients, but we have to keep in mind that these patients are coagulopathic, so, and it's a blind procedure, so one has to be careful. So the take-home message is aggressive intraoperative volume expansion. Raise the CVP to 10 to 15, which is what the textbook says, but we can safely raise it to 20-25 if the patient is healthy and the cardiovascular status is stable. This will help to avoid acute tubular necrosis secondary to inadequate hydration. So watch out for hypovolemia and hypotension at the time of reperfusion, and we will have early graft function. Thank you very much.
Thank Thank you. Yes, thank you very much, Dr. Rashmi, for the elaborate presentation which you have done, given all the pros and cons of successful donation as well as the transplantation. We move on to the next lecture, and we'll have the question section at the end of the party. And next is Dr. Jayashree Sood, who is going to introduce and start with the next lecture.
Hello, good evening, everybody. So now we have our next topic is anesthesia for liver transplant. And I don't think several of the attendees who are there today may not have seen a liver transplant during their career. And it's very important that, especially for the students, that they should know the anesthetic management of this problem. And in fact, if they get a chance, they should attend one of these tertiary care centers where liver transplant is being done regularly. For this lecture today, we have Dr. Nikunj Gupta. He is a senior consultant and a director of the transplant unit in Medanta, New Delhi. And they have a lot of experience, Nikunj and Dr. Vijay, who is the moderator today. They have a lot of experience in liver transplant and they do exclusive liver transplant. So I'm sure with Nikunj Gupta's lecture, the anesthesia for liver transplant, it'll be an eye-opener for several of attendees. Dr. Nikunj, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the kind introduction. Good evening, all. And thanks to the ICA and all the panelists. Dr. Kumra, thank you so much. Dr. Radhakrishnan, Dr. Jay, of course, and Dr. Vijay Vora. So always been my teacher and mentor. So my topic for today is anesthesia for liver transplant. Sir Thomas Scholl, in 1963, conducted the first human liver transplant. And in 1967, he performed the first successful human liver transplant. In 1982, the first clinical use of cyclosporine was done. And in 1991, tacrolimus was first used by the same Sir Thomas Scholl. As we all know, liver transplantation is two types, life-related liver transplantation and the diseased donor liver transplantation. In diseased donor liver transplantation, we remove the diseased liver and take out the en-masse liver from the disease, and end-to-end anastomosis of the vena cava is done. I can't move my slides.
Yeah, you can use the lower top, lower left part, plus minus is there.
Okay. So live donor liver transplant is a more complex surgery where the split graft is taken from the donor, usually the right lobe, and the anastomosis of first the hepatic vein, then the portal vein, hepatic artery, and the bile duct are done. So the two major goals of liver transplantation are to prolong survival of the patient in end stage liver disease patient and to improve quality of life to decrease the morbidity and mortality. To some extent, it has shown promising results because there is improvement in organ preservation. The surgical techniques are more protocolized. With the advent of better immunosuppressive agents like tacrolimus, we have a better understanding of coagulopathy now, and there are newer antibiotics has been introduced. So coming to the indications of the liver transplant in adult patients, when we started the liver transplant program, it was hepatitis C, which used to account 20 to 25% of the patient. But now, alcoholic cirrhosis, NASH, cryptogenic cirrhosis related to malignancies are the major number. And in pediatric patient, biliary atresia remains the first choice, Then it's related, ALF is the second number, and then comes the metabolic disorders. So what are the contraindications to liver transplant? These are severe cardiac or pulmonary diseases, extrahepatic malignancy, like when the malignancy goes beyond the liver and it is said outside the Milan's criteria, systemic infection. We don't want any patient to operate on any kind of infection, because infection remains the main, say, of any mortality or morbidity after the transplant. Psychiatric and psychosocial substance abuse. It is our protocol, or worldwide it is accepted, that 3 to 6 months of abstinence is required. This is extensive thrombosis is more or less a surgical contraindication. Then obesity, more than 35. I put a question mark here just because it could not be an absolute indication, because GDLT can still be a choice in morbid obese patients. We all know there's a limited supply of organs versus the organ. So to prioritize the organs, and for the prognostic indices, we have two main scoring system, CTP and the model of end stage. CTP scoring have got 5 components, bilirubin, albumin, INR, ascites, and hepatic encephalopathy. The minimum points allotted are 1 point, and the maximum is 3 point. So if these are, suppose, and if the points are increased, like 10 to 5 in child, say, the mortality increases and the survival rate decreases. Here you see ascites and hepatic encephalopathy has got inter-absorber biasism, and also it does not incorporate the renal function. So to overcome this, they have come with the model of end-stage liver disease, where 3 components are there, bilirubin, INR, and serum creatinine. This is an algorithm of MELT. It looks complicated, but once you put the values here, the MELT score comes. So it is originally formulated in the patient waiting for the transplant and undergone TEPS. So little bit about the pathophysiology of the ECLD. As we all know, liver is the main metabolic organ of the body, the largest organ of the body, most vascular organ of the body. So when it gets insulted by alcohol, viruses, fatty liver, then the chronic changes start coming. And eventually, it is the fibrotic changes come, and it becomes cirrhotic liver or end-stage liver disease. And here it becomes irreversible. The physiology becomes irreversible here. Again, I just thought I'll put this diagram. This is the biliary canaliculi. These are the hepatocytes. So when the toxins, viruses, or alcohol, they get affected, hepatocytes get affected, and the macrophages, fibroblasts start accumulating. So they start compressing these veins. These veins are compressed here, and it causes the back pressure to the portal vein or hepatic artery. And then the main pathophysiology comes because of this back pressure. Fluid moves out of the peritoneal cavity and is known as ascites. When back pressure, again, it causes renal vasoconstriction and causes the hepatorenal syndrome. There is a congestive splenomegaly. So one must understand this is the back pressure causing because of the hepatocytes are damaged, and then fibroblasts, macrophages are accumulated and they are pressing the veins. We all know these chronic liver patients are chronically vasodilated. So what is happening here? This is causing hypotension, decreased vascular resistance, which in turn there is a compensatory elevated cardiac output, and hyperdynamic circulation is there. And also because of the chemicals secreted from the liver, it causes cirrhotic cardiomyopathy. Almost 20 to 25% of ECLD patients are having a cardiomyopathy. Respiratory system, there is definitely a ventilation perfusion mismatch, which causes hepatopulmonary syndrome, causes portopulmonary hypertension, and this is always some restrictive element and causes the restrictive lung changes. So hepatopulmonary syndrome Hepatopulmonary syndrome has a triad, that is dyspnea at rest, low oxygen saturation, and PO2 of less than 80 or some books 60, because it is differentiated into mild, moderate, and the severe. So the classical symptom of the hepatopulmonary syndrome is a platypnea, that is shortness of breath on sitting up. And then there is an orthodeoxia, that is fall in saturation on the standing. If see this diagram, the ventilation is proper, but because of the vasodilatation, the vasculature, the arteries, the blood passing is not perfused properly. So shunted blood is transfused to all the organs, causing the hypoxia. Otopulmonary hypertension, again, when the mean arterial pressure is more than 25, resistance is more than 120, and pulmonary capillary wedge is less than 15. Why I am emphasizing here much? Because we should rule out this is not a patient of the, there is no hypervolemia in this. And we all know Swan gauge catheter is the gold standard for measuring the otopulmonary hypertension. Renal system, when renal failure occurs in cirrhotic patient, in ECLD patient, in the absence of intrinsic renal disease, then it is known as HRS. There is a, as I told, mediators, chemical mediators are secreted from the cirrhotic liver, which causes renal vasoconstriction and eventually causes the hepatorenal syndrome. The percentage of HRS in cirrhotic patients, it could be high as 40 to 60%. This percentage vary, but this is very high percentage of patients having a HRS in cirrhotic patients. So when serum creatinine more than 1.5, creatinine clearance less than 40, and urine volume less than 500 ml in 24 hours, and there is no intrinsic disease, then the patient is known as hepatorenal in the hepatorenal syndrome. The pathophysiology I've already discussed. First, coagulation system, we all know liver plays a very important part in coagulation. When liver failure is there, there is a reduced synthesis of all the coagulation factors, there is a malabsorption of vitamin K, there is inadequate hepatic clearance, and there is thrombocytopenia also. There is some because of the impaired aggregation and because of the increased adhesiveness. So what we do in the preoperative evaluation, we do all the routine testing and we do all the coagulation profile, respiratory chest X-ray spirometry. In cardiac evaluation, we do all that, but we have started screening the calcium scoring also. Anything above 0 or 100 is considered to be positive, and then it should be further evaluated. Assessment here, this is our mainly the surgical to know the anatomy of the donor and the two recipient. And other is, this is important, psychosocial assessment, prepare for the patient, what is going, this is the procedure, what is going to happen, and then you have to be very strong after the transplant. Nutritional assessment, again, I want to emphasize that nutritional assessment is very important. I have seen patients who are nutritionally not nourished, not very good, they don't do well after the transplantation program. So what are the immediate preoperative checkup? Authorization committee, we always, as soon as the patient comes to the operation theater, we make sure the authorization, proper authorization committee is there, informed consent obviously. And we always arrange 10 units of RBC, FFP 10 units. These can differ institute to institute, but our protocol at Medanta, we usually arrange 10 units of PRBC and FFP and four units of platelet apheresis. Preoperative coagulation profile, obviously we do, and to do, and all the electrolyte and arterial blood gas analysis before the surgery. So coming to the anesthesia technique, we give hydrogen S2 receptor blocker. We all know these have a patient having a huge ascites. They have a gastric paresis. So rapid sequence induction is always there. Then prophylactic, and our protocol is we give antibiotic 1 hour before the surgery, and nasogastric tube, please don't take it lightly, this patient. There has been instances when nasogastric tube, there was so much of bleeding when we have to postpone the surgery because of just nasogastric tube has caused so much of bleeding. So we should not take lightly. We maintain on oxygen, air, and isoflurane. anesthesia technique, fentanyl, sufentanyl. The relaxant of choice is etraquilurium here. Dr. Vijay Vora, like 15 days back, I was listening. He delivered a wonderful lecture on the relaxant on liver transplantation, and cisetraquilurium was the choice. I'm sorry, it's not mentioned here. Then, of course, acetylcysteine and tranexamic acid whenever it is indicated. Vascular access, two large bore cannulas are there. This is the advanced venous access. Everybody must have seen this. And why I've shown this picture? The proper pacing of central lines in proper aseptic technique is required. And most important thing where I want to emphasize is there should be no loose end here, because there are chances of air embolism. And I deliberately unclamp this. This should not happen like this. Everything should be unclamped. It should be clamped here, it should be clamped here, there should be a clave connector here. So there should be no chance to entry of the air. Monitoring all the routine parameter, arterial line, usually we put a radial catheter, pulmonary artery catheter when it is required, in portopulmonary hypertension, then the cardiac monitors. Of course, the temperature and urine output is important. Laboratory investigation, these are the arterial blood gas analysis and thromboelastography. This is the sampling intraoperatively we do by the thromboelastography and AB. This is the thromboelastography. I just want to emphasize on the red part. This is the reaction time is increased, so we give fresh frozen plasma here. The maximum amplitude is decreased, so we give platelets here. So we monitor coagulation intraoperatively as per the thromboelastography. So these are the stages of liver transplant: pre-anhepatic, anhepatic, and neo-anhepatic. Pre-anhepatic are when all the ligament attached to the ligaments are divided. So what is happening in pre-anhepatic state? There is an acute loss of ascitic fluid. So we must replace this ascitic fluid. Either severe ascites, we can request surgeon to remove the ascitic fluid slowly. Then, and we should fill the compartment. We should fill either by crystallites or colloids or albumin, as per it depends as per the patient or as per the individual choice. Bleeding, definitely bleeding can occur because there's a lots of venous collectors in the mesentery. There could be a history of SVP. There could be a history of previous surgery. So bleeding is always can be there, and we should be always prepared to transfuse blood. And when we are transfusing blood, we should take care of all the electrolytes, calcium or potassium. Abdominal retraction, this is very important. The surgeons are very fond of retracting the abdomen, and it causes decreased venous return. So we can always politely request the surgeon to loosen the clamps. So how do you manage this? We should do the volume expansion. We should take care of all the electrolytes. And hematic phase is when there is no blood supply to the liver. When we clamp the portal vein, when there is no inflow to the liver, and ends with the reperfusion when three venous clamps are removed and the donor liver is perfused. So the anesthetic challenges in hepatic phase are all the things, the coagulopathy, the acid-base balance, the electrolytes, build differences, or get potentiated. So we must take care of this, and definitely vasopressors are increased during this period. Venovenous bypass was first, like maybe 15 years back we used to put, but now because of the embolization, hypothermia, I don't think anybody uses the venovenous bypass. And acetylcysteine, definitely there are papers which say there's a reduction in ischemia reperfusion injury and there's an improved renal function. So we always, this is a protocol for last one, we always put an infusion of an acetylcysteine, but it's an individual choice. Vasopressor, definitely noradrenaline is a choice. But as per the patient demand, as per the surgery, we can put terlipressin in HRS patient, we can put vasopressin, or we can transfer adrenaline as well. Organ preservation, this is very important. This is, there are two main solution, perfusionate fluids, UW solution and STK solution. So worldwide STK is used, but in Medanta, we are very comfortable in using the UW solution. So this is the individual choice. Now comes the IVC clamping. As we clamp the cava, we see here the cardiac output is falling, the SVR is increasing, and there's a definite fall in urine output also. So vasopressor, the noradrenaline is always right, so we have to take support of the adrenaline, noradrenaline to support the hemodynamics. Mannitol we usually give before the reperfusion because it acts as an osmotic diuretic, and it also acts as a scavenging action. Now comes the reperfusion. Reperfusion is first you unclamp the, when you unclamp the cava, there's sudden gush of blood and there's an increased cardiac output, there's an increased blood pressure. Then once patient blood pressure is stabilized to a certain level like 140 systolic or 150, then we ask the surgeon to unclamp the portal vein. And when portal vein is clamped, there's a mean fall in mean arterial pressure, there's fall in systemic vasoconstriction, because the cold acidotic hyperkalemic solution is being flushed from the graft directly into the heart. And this may cause hypotension, this may cause right heart dysfunction, there's arrhythmias can occur, and even cardiac arrest. Though it is not a very common entity nowadays, but yes, we should always be careful. And till date, after so much of experience, we always make sure that we have two syringes of adrenaline available at the time of reperfusion, one in 10,000 and one in 1 lakh solution. So to prevent ischemia reperfusion injury, we give calcium to counteract potassium influx, bicarbonates to offset acidosis, and of course vasopressor to maintain the hemodynamics. Now comes the new hepatic stage. After reperfusion, we have new hepatic. Now the liver, new liver is flowing. Now we should know about the fluid. Colloids, crystalloid, albumin, it depends. No, there is no ideal crystalloid or colloid, and all have their own limitation. So it is per individual patient, per how the surgery depend. Suppose the albumin is low in any patient, so definitely my choice will be albumin. So albumin maintains plasma and decreases the need for postoperative cardiology. This is a paper. So now the postoperative care. Duration of surgery is around 8 to 10 hours in LDLT and lesser in DDLT, and the hospital stay is usually 1 to 4 weeks. So continuous monitoring of cardiovascular, pulmonary, renal, and neurological status is required. Early extubation, now fast tracking is done by in many institutes. We also do approximately 10 to 15 patients in the patient. We do the extubation on the table. Rest are extubated, most of the patient are extubated 4 to 6 hours in the ICU after the surgery. There are some institutes which are doing fast tracking, and they as good as 40 to 50% are extubated on the table. Immunosuppression, as I told you, tacrolimus is a revolution now, and tacrolimus with the steroid has started in the postoperative period by the under the guidance of hepatologist. We should know how the graft, whether graft is functioning or not. There is a rise in body temperature, hyperglycemia, normalization of the coagulopathy. There is bioproduction, graft lactate start clearance. There is a decreased inotropic requirement. So all these show that our graft is functioning well. So this is just, I just thought to put, ability to transfuse rapidly is vital to successful outcome in liver transplantation. Why I'm telling this? This picture is not very uncommon in liver transplant. This could occur 1 in 20 or 1 in 25 transplant, and this is not very uncommon. So I just thought of putting this rapid infusion in system level 1. This is capable of transfusing 500 ml to 1 liter of blood in 1 minute. And also, it can take care of your humidification, it can take care of your temperature control, and also it absorbs all the emboli. So there is no fear of air embolism by this rapid infusion system. Blood conservation strategies are definitely we maintain the lower CVP, and cell saver, nowadays cell saver is not used. because there is a chances of infection and we are very scared of infection. And then definitely it is not effective, is not indicated in pathology or malignancy. We just can't use in the Sansevieria in these pathology conditions. Postoperative management, continuous hemodynamic monitoring is required. If we can, we fast tracking is always indicated. Then immunosuppression with the help of hepatologist. Heparin if there is a hepatic artery thrombosis and assessment of the graft function. Prevention of infection, as I said, prevention of infection is at most important. Proper blood sampling, sterile blood sampling, ETU and TU handling, barrier nursing, care of the bladder and stream, everything is required in proper sterile condition. So to prevent sepsis, because we should always remember any mortality or morbidity cause after liver transplant, the most important cause is the sepsis. So at any cause, we should be preventing sepsis in the patient. So to conclude, liver transplant is a viable option for end-stage liver disease in developed countries. Anesthetic management remains complex and challenging as always. A coordinated and committed approach is required for surgeon, anesthesiologists, intensivists, and hepatologists. Thank you so much for the patience.
Thank you, Dr. Nikunj, for that very good overview on the management of liver transplant. Thanks a lot. I'm sure there'll be several queries from the attendees. And coming to the last topic of transplant, which is a very important part, that is the diseased donor management of the organ transplantation. In the north, we don't get to see so many diseased donors for the transplantation. In the south, it is very common. However, in the northern India, because of the rituals and the beliefs of the North Indians, it's not that common. Of course, again, it is common, very common in the west. However, in the east, it is not so. Korea, etc., they all do live donor transplantations. So for this disease donor management, which is so important, we have a very senior anesthesiologist, a very dynamic lady, Major General Rashmi Datta, and she is a senior consultant anesthesiology and critical care, and she's posted in New Delhi. They have a vast, the army have a vast experience in disease donor management. And for this, I invite Dr. Rashmi Datta for her lecture.
Thank you, ma'am. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It is a pleasure. And firstly, I'd like to thank the ICA for giving me this opportunity. And you all, ma'am, it's nice to see our great stalwarts over here, Dr. Kumra, Dr. Radhakrishnan, everybody. It's really nice to see all of them. I'll just be taking you through the diseased donor management for organ transplant. It is donation of a biological tissue or an organ of the human body from the living to the dead, but we are now dealing only here with the dead. There are two options. We have opt-in, opt-out, different countries. Anybody who has not given consent for organ donation is not a donor. Different countries believe in that. And opt-out is anybody who has not refused is a donor. So we are a opt-in type of country. And like you said, ma'am, it is very, very difficult here, especially in the northern part of the country, to convince people. And it's not just the NOK or somebody who has to be convinced. It is anybody, we have a lot of challenges with that. The recognized mechanisms of death, both of them are there. We are not, there's a donation after death by circulatory criteria or the non-beating heart donation, but I'll not be talking much about this. I'll be talking about donation after death by neurological criteria, where we are, where the patient's the heart is beating, but the patient by neurological, the same either total brainstem death or total brain death or brainstem death is can be declared dead. Now, in India, we follow only the brainstem type of death. We do not follow the total brain death, which is normally followed in USA and the allied and there a few other countries. Here, because we follow the same this brainstem death, it permits criteria which are there to be derived, which are testable and which one can document also. With this, because we are not talking about the total brain death, therefore EEG does not figure very prominently in our testing for brain death. Now, in the Indian scenario, we had about, in 1994, it was the Transplant of Human Organ Act, and through the years, amendments and which came in there, sorry, amendments and other things which came in after that, it was in 2014, Transplant of Human Organs and Tissue Rules was made. Now, in this, there's a few little differences which are there that we require. The organ retrieval centers have come in, and it has now become compulsory for the ICU staff to intimate about the brain death and suggest for organ donations with permission for the same. Earlier on, we were not supposed to do it, but still we would like to avoid counseling the families. The ICU staff is looking at it, looking after the patient. We normally avoid them to be talking to the family or repeatedly requesting the family for organ donation. That is what we normally leave it to the transplant coordinator. They have also made provisions for postmortem. If the postmortem has to be conducted, then the doctor can be present inside the OT for medico-legal cases, because we lost out on a lot of cases because of medico-legal. They were medico-legal cases, so we were not able to take them. The coordinator, transplant coordinator, has now become mandatory, and the authorization committees are formed more, therefore, to allow delay in, to prevent any delay in getting donation if it is if the relatives agree. Certification for brain death now has been made by the ICU doctor than the anesthesiologist. Because to ease the pressure from the neurologist, which was earlier on there. And tissue donation does not need a doctor. That part has also come in. So for today, we have an anesthesiologist, an intensivist, or a neurologist, or a neurosurgeon. Any of them can certify, along with the second specialist, which is authorized by the state, the treating physician, and the medical administrator who has to be in charge of the hospital. All four signatures are there on the forms, which are very clear. Now, the potential donors. The ideal donor is one who has got a brain injury, fatal brain injury with impending or actual brain death, but the CV, the cardiovascular functions are normally intact. These are usually found in the cared for in the ICU, but can be identified anywhere else, most important in the emergency department. And this stresses upon the awareness which is required in the hospital. All the doctors, all the paramedical, they should be a little aware of this, that somebody can be a potential donor. Free of illness. Now, among the criteria for potential donors, they were free for illness, which is there. But however, donor sepsis is not a complete contraindication. Yes, it should not be affecting the other organs. There should not be multiple system organ failure. Most of the things they have now, they are a little liberal with the criteria for potential donors. However, the exclusion criteria, more than 80 years poisoning and the severe infection, including HIV, the hepatitis B, C. Nowadays, though they're taking cases with the B also, they are taking a few cases in case required, and TB and sepsis. These are the ones which are the same. The possible indications which give alerts us to that is the presence of diabetes insipidus, hypotension, which requires more than one pressor, or inotrope and hypothermia. These are one of the first indications, but non-reactive pupils should not trigger the process of establishing brain death. The testing, I'll just be briefly, quickly covering it, because this is also part of the management of a potential donor. You have the general physical examination, then the neurological examination, and the confirmatory test. few confounders which are very important to be ruled out before people start jumping on to the apnea testing. One of them is severe electrolyte disturbances, and one factor which normally is not taken into consideration is hypophosphatemia. So one should get phosphate also in the normal panel, which we get in the ICU, we should do the same. Acid-based disturbances to be ruled out, hypothermia if the core temperature is less than 32, certain endocrine disturbances, presence of drug intoxication or poisoning has to be kept in mind. Also, then we have certain medical conditions such as brainstem encephalitis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, Lockton syndrome. These are the type of things which one has to rule out before one can think in terms of brainstem death, or even trying to examine for that. The documentation is very important. I keep stressing on this because ICU, we keep changing very frequently on a rotation basis. So therefore, the documentation has to be done so that it is reproducible by the other person who may be seeing the patient after 6 hours, say. Deep coma should be there. It should be maintained on a ventilator. The patient should be maintained for at least 6 hours if there's a cardiac arrest. Then minimum of 24 hours is required after the return of spontaneous circulation. No decorticate or decerebrate posturing should be present. Frank decorticate or decerebrate, because sometimes you can't have Lazarus movements. I'll just talk about it. No elliptiform movements should be observed, because it may be that patient may be in status, which is not the same, and it will give the same feeling of having being unresponsive. No spontaneous respiratory movement and no shivering. While we'll talk about no spontaneous respiratory movements, these patients are usually on the ventilators, and if the trigger is kept low, it may show one little spike on the monitor for as if it is a spontaneous movement, which is not fully, which can initiate a respiratory breath. However, therefore, the trigger should be not less than one. This is just what I said, they should be recorded well. This is the Lazarus sign in which there are spontaneous movements of limbs, and we have lost a lot of potential donors because of the presence of Lazarus sign. It is very difficult to explain to the relatives who are already emotional at that particular time, sometimes even difficult to explain to the physicians that these are Lazarus movements. They do not exclude brain death, and these movements are over there. The respiratory-like movements like shoulder elevation and abduction, the intercostal expansion without any significant tidal volume, that all has to be there. Sweating, blushing, normal BP without vasopressors, all these are part of what can be taken as Lazarus the same, and the absence of deep tendon reflexes, all these Babinski's reflexes, all do not exclude brain death.
We are not able to see the slides.
Not able to see the slide?
Dr. Kumra. Either they're seeing or they are also not seeing.
Yes, we can see it. We can see it.
We can see as well.
Not see any. I cannot see any slide.
I'm screen sharing here.
Sir, we can see.
That's fine, Rashmi.
Right. Spinal cord reflexes, I always highlight over there that the spinal cord function or reflexes can return back after the initial absence, even when there is no brainstem death. The tests which normally are there is cerebral and functions which we normally talk about. One is the cold calorie test, normally it is known as quick cows. Most of the students are aware of this. And so that is cold is on the opposite side for the quick movement of the nystagmus, and warm is on the same side. This is normally done with 50 ml. One has to be a little careful with this because if the tympanic membrane should not get damaged with this, because that can cause further problems. The various cranial nerves are tested out, right, including the vagus. Vagus, we test, do the atropine testing for the vagus, and a whole lot of other tests which are done for all the various cranial nerves which are tested. The plan normally comes as if there is no spontaneous respiration, then we stop the muscle relaxants, then we check for the brainstem reflexes after 2 hours. After that, the brainstem reflexes, we stop, check that, then just stop the sedatives and narcotics if they are anything, and then again check for after 2 hours. The apnea test, which is the test for before we declare them declare the patient as brainstem death, has to be done very meticulously, because that is what is the thing. If it is not done, we are likely to get caught over there. The tidal volume of about 6 ml per kg, it is normally the same. With the pre-oxygenation, we switch over to an FiO2 of 1. Baseline ABG is done. It is a ventilator. We disconnect the ventilator. 100% oxygen is delivered at 6 liters per minute through the endotracheal tube via a catheter, which is just beyond the level of the endotracheal tube. And we have to observe for respiratory and or abdominal movements. And after about 10 minutes, we observe the we repeat the ABG and then reconnect the patient to the ventilator. A positive test is the patient if he is apneic without any respiratory movement and there is a rise of the carbon dioxide more than 60 millimeter mercury or more than 20 millimeter from the baseline. Our laws say it should be more than 60, but other countries, they also go for more than 60. 60 more than 20. 60 is taken as this because at that particular time, the apneic center gets stimulated to produce any type of respiration, if suppose it is possible there. So if that does not come at 60, that means the apneic center in the brain is also not working. A negative test is if the apnea is not present, certain respiratory efforts come in. However, many times what happens is that we get an equivocal test. And if it doesn't rise, and it should be aborted if suppose there is hypotension, arrhythmias, or if the SpO2 falls less than 91. We tend to push in at this particular time. It should be avoided over there and repeat after another 6 hours. Now, once the test is done, depending on the age of the patient, since we normally deal with adult patients, we do repeat it afterwards. We repeat the apnea test afterwards. After about, say, this is the second apnea test is the time when we declare the patient dead. And that is the time when we take the patient, we can take the patient to the operation theater for organ retrieval. Therefore, in between the first test and the second test is done once all the paperwork is over and the relatives are also, they have had their, we give them some time with the patient so that they can say their goodbyes and then they carry on. Isoelectric, suppose for some time you cannot do it. Okay, I'll skip this part. Atropine, EEG, all these other tests which are there, which are the confirmatory tests, are usually not necessary for a brainstem death. They are only required in case it is not possible to perform the apneic test for some or the other reason, but without the apnea test, one doesn't do it. Legally, we are not allowed to retrieve organs. So this is the whole pyramid which comes in. There's coma, there is cause of identify, the cause is identified and see whether the coma is irreversible. And a whole lot of other temperature is seen. The other confounding factors are ruled out. Any confounding agents, pharmaceutical agents are there. There's no poisoning, no motor response, no spinal cord response, the absent pupils, pupillary respond, all these tests over there. And finally, the person it can be declared brainstem dead. Now coming on to the organ management, and here we are running against time because at one hand we have different type of guidelines in our country about managing it, both the ICCM and of course NOTO also has its own. The goals of this is very clear. Firstly, it is organ early donor recognition. That is important. The accurate declaration of brainstem death is there because this can easily turn in with our current scenario. It can easily turn very quickly into a very, very uncomfortable and potential problematic situation where they can accuse the hospital of trying to, you know, harvest organs. So the brainstem death has to be the documentation of that has to be done very, very properly. Early ICU admission and management by the dedicated team. All the potential donors have to be treated. We have to refer them. We have to change the, and here I'm coming on to this, the hierarchy should be certain because we have faced many problems so that the person responsible is established. Sometimes in the northern part of the country where the wife is the NOK, but somebody senior may be there who may refuse even if the wife says yes. So this part has to be established. The protocol-based critical care has to be done for the organ to be there. What all intensivists should know, the people who are working there, the knowledge of the effect of brain death on each organ, the effect of the pre-op measures, whatever we are doing required, which is required by the donor in the ICU. The focus shifts immediately from cerebral protective strategies, which we have been doing up to now, once we realize the patient is brain dead, to optimizing the organ donors for transplantation to maintain the physiological hemostasis. But however, I'll not be covering the ex situ treatment of organs. I'll also not be talking about the part when we wheel the patient inside and the organs are being harvested. The critical level intensity of support has to continue, and the treatment of various other problems which are going to come just now, we have to be aware of it and we have to be ready to treat them. Most important comes the moment the patient is, we realize the patient is brain dead. And while the work is going on for getting the people to agree, the relatives to agree, and all the paperwork is going on, this simultaneously starts. Invasive hemodynamic monitoring has to start. If the central line has not been put in, we put in a large bore peripheral line, intra-arterial line for whole pressure monitoring. We are now talking in terms of even the fluid, intraoperative fluid responsiveness. We are seeing the frequent ABG analysis we'll require, things like Ryle's tube, urinary catheter, and temperature monitors. This if have not been put in, should be put in at that particular time. ECG, SpO2, end-tidal carbon dioxide, and the transthoracic echo has to be done at that particular time. The testing has to start over there. Now we have to switch over immediately to an aggressive management and keeping everything ready for the teams who are going to be standby. Not only the TLC, DLC count, the platelet count, all the tests for any of these infections which can potentially stop us from a donation. The complete gamut of liver function tests, which includes AST, ALT, everything. The renal function test and all the electrolytes. Like I said, we have to take care even of calcium and phosphate also. Blood group has to be confirmed because this is where the problem comes in. At times, we have had a case where there was a doubt over the blood group, and we had a problem over the donation. X-ray chest has to be done if has not been done within the last 12 hours, and after that to be repeated every 24 hours. ECG, echocardiography, if in case required. HLA typing starts, the cross-matching also starts between the potential donors and the recipients. It starts at an angiography, if in case required, and we are thinking in terms of a cardiac transplant also. The mechanism, mechanical ventilation is immediately switched over. The aim is to keep the SpO2 as high as possible. So we give the adequate amount of PEEP. And along with that, what also we have is that PEEP is adjusted just to meet the pressure requirements. The SpO2 more than 95 it is. And PaO2 should be more than 70 at least. Aim also to be maintain a pH of about 7.35 to 7.45 in between. In between, we do a periodic recruitment maneuvers and oxygen challenge in case required, we can give that. There's a loss of hypothalamic temperature, this thing, because of the fall in the metabolic rate. The core temperature, once it comes down, there's a whole lot of problems which come into that, including right up to pancreatitis. So aggressive rewarming has to be done to maintain the temperature more than 34 degrees Celsius. When I say aggressive rewarming, it is not to give warm fluids, just the convective methods to be used. Care to be taken to avoid any burns. Yeah, because many times what happens is we put in a blower, hot air blower inside the blanket, and there may be some burns which will come there, and the relatives get very, obviously they are a little careful at that time. Hypotension is one of our biggest problems, because hypotension and hemodynamic instability. Hypotension can be due to any cause, because of the neurogenic, because of hypovolemic, because now we're going to give treatment for cerebral edema. Patient may have already been receiving that. DI also starts, or even because of hyperglycemia, there's osmotic diuresis. Then cardiogenic shock may also come over here because of hypothermic depression and for otherwise left ventricular dysfunction. Now, the choice of fluids which we are taking depends on the hemoglobin levels, whether crystalloid colloids, the circulatory parameters, and serum electrolytes. Hemoglobin, though, of course, we are talking about more than 7 at times. Some protocols mention 7, but we normally like to keep the thing at more than 10. We would like to keep it. That is the ideal parameter. The circulatory parameters, what we are looking for is the unary output should be around more than 1 ml per kg per hour. Should be around the same. The MAP is around 60 and less than 100. The CVP should be well maintained. And especially if we are going in for, like has been mentioned by Dr. Rashmi also, if you're going in for renal transplant, which is the most common one, the CVP can be even more higher. But this is the minimum which is required. The ejection fraction more than 45% should be there. So, and the various other parameters there. The electrolytes, these are the type of, it should be less than 145 milliequivalent. Glucose should be also maintained around 150 to 180. The expansion of the intravascular volume initially is by a balanced salt solution. Subsequently, it comes hypotension, hypotensive. Solution comes in, especially 5% dextrose, it is there, especially if suppose there is development of diabetes insipidus. HES obviously now is being avoided. We don't think of any other colloid except for 5% albumin if there is a PT and PTTK are, PTT are normal, and FFP to be given if they are abnormal, then we give them. PRBCs to be given in case the hemoglobin is less. Now coming on to, if suppose the hypotension is there, it is not being rectified by the just fluid replacement, then vasopressors have to be given. Low dose dopamine has again come back because of its, not only because of its vasoactive and inotropic effect, but they're suggesting because of the immunomodulatory effect and as well as the reactive oxygen free radical scavenging effect. And they have found a low rate of graft rejection in both kidney and in heart recipients. So first line is again back to dopamine. After that, in case it is not getting, the BP doesn't come up, then we add levothyroxine. It's about 20 mics we give it, and then followed by an infusion. And then we switch over to vasopressin, because at this particular time, patient is going to be acidotic also. So a non-catecholamine inotrope is better. Vasopressin, 1 unit bolus, and followed by, you can give it either as a continuous bolus, 0.02 or 0.01 units per hour. We titrate it and give it. This is normally considered even the first line of treatment, because it independently approves this, and simultaneously where one has diabetes insipidus, so one can, it helps in the treatment of that also. Other drugs which are there are phenylephrine, dopamine, epinephrine, depending on whether there's a cardiogenic shock or whether there's any other problem, we can use that. Among the endocrine disturbances, which are very, very often, the thing, one is the role of T3, which has been found to be very normal, very responsible for any decrease in the for increase in the graft rejection. So T3 or T4 both have been found equally effective. So we normally give T4 if suppose they are hemodynamically unstable, and if there is a cardiac donor with ejection fraction of less than 45%. Also, there is insulin resistance, so therefore target is, as per the normal ICU protocol, target is between 150 to 180. We don't look for a very tight control over here. Diabetes insipidus, that is very, it has to be, because that ADH depletion comes in very rapidly. So the diuresis, inappropriate diuresis, that leads to severe hypovolemia, instability, and instability, as well as electrolyte disturbances. The urinary output suddenly increases. That is one of the first signs which come in, which is there. And since we are monitoring the urinary output every hourly, we come to know that is one of the first signs which comes that this is diabetes insipidus is setting in. Serum sodium starts rising up and the osmolarity, serum osmolarity increases. The urine osmolarity decreases with the specific gravity getting less than about 1.0, or it becomes less than that. So therefore, the monitoring of urinary output as well as the urinary sodium and urinary specific gravity is of very tantamount importance. So if at that particular time, along with diabetes mellitus, if suppose there is just plain simple hypotension, then AVP to be started. It starts at a low dose of so many of 0.01 and gradually increase, and every hourly we increase it international units per minute. If it is diabetes insipidus plus hypernatremia without the hypotension, then desmopressin is preferred. It normally be nasal spray is okay. Redosing, seeing the effect on the sodium, serum sodium, the urinary output, and the urine osmolarity. However, if there is hypotension also, both the drugs, desmo as well as ABP, both of them can be given simultaneously. Low levels of cortisol is there. Has been documented, and so there are two doses, where two regimes in which you can give methylprednisolone, either it's at 15 milligram per kg every 24 hours, or a bolus is given. Normally the bolus is preferred, followed by a continuous infusion. This is the T4 protocol, in which all these drugs are mixed together. That is 1 ampule of 50% dextrose, 2 milligram of solmedrol, 20 units of regular insulin, and levothyroxine, and that is given at a constant rate. And it is given. It has been reported to show a good graft acceptance rate. Very important is the nutritional support. This is because the hepatic glycogens and the ATP sources have to, there's depletion of that both during warm and cold ischemia. So we have to take care of this before we prepare the for organ retrieval. Moderate amount of carbohydrates and lipids, amino acids, they give better better results for graft survival. Apart from that, surveillance for infection, the routine blood cultures, x-rays, urine culture, all these have to be done. The normal ICU protocols and non-nephrotoxic antibiotics to be given, taking care of MRSA and VRE screening. After that, we take that and we do it. Antifungals to be started only in case we are thinking there's a, firstly, there's a frank antifungal fungal growth, or if there is, we are thinking in terms of lung transplant. DIC may be present because of the necrotic brain tissue and may persist despite all these factors, this thing, and this requires early organ retrieval. And this normally happens when there's a long time in the family deciding whether to give or, you know, whether to go for donation or not to go for donation. The newer modalities which we are talking about is ischemic preconditioning, especially in the term both the solid organs, up to 10 minutes. That the thing, that this is one possibility which will help to prepare for the warm and the cold ischemic time subsequently. Antioxidant therapies have been tried variously, but nothing specific or no the same various case reports and minus a level of evidence is there. N-acetylcysteine, sevoflurane has also been tried, and alpha-lipoic acid has been tried, but there are various reports about it. It is because there are case reports about sevoflurane being used as an antioxidant therapy, therefore that is one of the preferred inhalation agents which you give at the time of organ retrieval. The viable, the clinical variables which will affect the short-term graft function is not, apart from the age, sex, and the ABO type, cause of death, as well as the ICU length of stay. Any if the patient is the donor is hypernatremic, and if the cold ischemic time is more than 1 minute, and if the warm ischemic time is and the nutrition and the glucose liver glycogen is depleted, and the use of hypotensive as well as vasoactive drugs, the more drugs are used, the less of the graft function. Definitely it has an effect on that. So thank you very much. I think we'll be taking the questions after this.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Rashmi.
Thank you, sir.
That was really elaborate. There were a lot of questions coming in, but I think you answered most of them.
Sir.
So tell me a few things that came through, which I'll start off with. One is someone was asking that hormone therapy, do you give it to all patients or do you give it selectively? And if you give it selectively, when do you give hormone therapy? Hormone therapy means steroids, thyroxine and insulin.
So insulin, the combination is one thing which we give, not in many, this thing. First I'll come to the individual one, sir. Now the steroids are normally given, sir. We prefer to give steroids. Methylprednisolone, we prefer to give when the first brainstem death has been, got that. We normally prefer to start methylpred, sir. Yeah. Number one. Number two, insulin at that particular time. So they require insulin. So insulin is given along with that. Thyroxine and the combination of all these given as a T3, T4 protocol. Thyroxine, we have started not in all the cases, a few cases wherever there is hypotension and the patient, the requirement of the vasopressors is quite high. At that particular time, we given thyroxine, sir. So we have given in few cases where we had to give supplement thyroxine, but the frank use of the T4 protocol in which all of them are put in one, one bag and then transfused, that normally is not required in all the cases. If the vasopressor requirement is increasing, then the thyroxine level is given, sir. Thyroxines are given, sir. Levothyroxine.
So you're giving it only if they are hemodynamically unstable or if they require high inotropes. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Now, another question that has come in about brain death.
Sir.
When do you declare brain death? Let's say they don't donate. Is the first test which you did, that is the time we will give it as a brain death, the person has died, or when you do the second test?
Sir, if they don't want to donate, then we don't do the second test, sir.
You have done the test.
I have done the first test, sir. Once we do the first test, we realize that the patient is brain dead. After that, we start asking for donations, sir. We also normally follow the Ramachandra protocol. That is a very useful way of doing it. Now, that means first start asking for the eyes and then gradually go up over there. By that time, the transplant coordinator has already motivated them. So if suppose they are there, suppose they do not agree to organ donation, then we do not do the second brainstem death testing, sir. And at the time of cardiac arrest is the one which we declare them. Then they die by cardiac arrest, sir. The time of death, we cannot discontinue the ventilator or based on the first brainstem death, sir, the testing. So if suppose the organ donation is not happening, then we wait. We have to ventilate the patient till the time the cardiac standstill does not take place.
Okay. Now there's one more question there. What is your preferred CVP if all the organs are being retrieved? You're going to have heart, liver, kidney, everything. Is there any preference of CVP or what is your... How do you fluid manage? Let's put it that way.
Fluid management, if I'll be very dissing apart, it sounds theoretically, sir, 12 to 15 centimeter water should be there, sir. That is theoretical. But practically, I'll tell you one thing, that when the patient is in diabetes insipidus patient, we are just pushing in fluids. And normally, at the rate of, say, about to one ml per kg per hour, and we are plus the previous hours urinary balance, so it becomes quite a bit. We are giving in enormous amount of fluid and patient is also losing the fluid, sir. So maintaining the CVP practically is, if I'm able to achieve about 12 to 15, I'll be quite happy, sir. Suppose it's a hepatic, a renal transplant, we would like to have a little bit more and this thing. But 12 to 15, if you are able to maintain it, it's good enough, sir. Because on one hand, sir, the patient is just pouring out urine. We'll have to control with the once we put in the vasopressors and diabetes is controlled, insipidus is controlled, sir. We are putting in a lot of fluids over there. So about 12 to 15 is what we get. 12 to 14 is what we normally get.
And one last question that is coming. When will you use the ancillary tests if in diagnosing brain death?
Sir, ancillary tests. I just rushed over that slide because I thought about time. Ancillary tests, including atropine testing and getting the EEG taken and getting your ultrasound of the Doppler and all that, all these they are only in case of, so we normally don't get them done, sir. They are given over there, but we normally have not yet got any of these done, sir. Practically, I'm just telling you that.
The question was coming in case we are not able to complete some of their tests. Let's say patient is getting desaturated and you're not sure. You've not really been able to do the test. So,
The patient is getting desaturated if developing hypotension at that particular time, the ancillary tests, that's where we normally discontinue the test, sir. At that particular time, sir, even if I do an atropine test or I get that empty skull sign, sir, we try to look for that. Yeah. Yeah. Or I get those the Doppler of the great veins or great thing of the neck, sir.
Yeah.
Even if I get all that done, sir, it is still going to remain only an ancillary test. Yeah. The point comes the apnea testing, sir. As far as legality is concerned, even the other people, they do not till the time the apnea test is not done, sir, they are not very interesting. So we normally then do not ask for organ donation at that particular time. This is, I'm talking about practically. So though theoretically we can do the ancillary test, they are there because either way brainstem will not respond to atropine. Now, that is why even if there is hypotension or bradycardia, we do not give atropine at all, sir. We can't give that, sir. So therefore maximum, if suppose there's bradycardia, we switch over to dopamine. We don't give atropine at all. These testing again, they're ancillary, but practically, sir, this is what we are facing.
Okay. Now one person is just reading. What route thyroxin is given? That, of course, you do it through the Ryle's tube.
Okay. Through the Ryle's tube, sir.
Yeah. Is it simultaneous harvesting? Of course not. It has to be cardiac gets the priority. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Cardiac gets the priority, sir. That is first. Liver and then kidney, sir. That's how we can.
Yeah. Okay. Great. I think that's about all we have questions on that. Anybody else?
Sir, just one question, one query. Can we do the first brain dead patient without the consent of the relatives?
The first brain death testing is done without the consent, can be done without the consent of the relatives, but it is always better to, because since we are going, after that we are running against time. Once we have confirmed it, we are running against time. It is not mandated that you require the consent of the relatives. However, it is always better to get, because you're doing a procedure on a patient which is going to be further traumatic to the NOK. So it is always better to tell the relatives, explain to them, and then tell them that I'm going in to test whether the brain has died or not.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Rashmi. Could we have a question or two for Rashmi Jain, please? Rashmi, I just wanted to know that although you have highlighted on the Ringer's lactate nowadays, what is your preference of the fluid to be used during the renal recipient surgery?
We are still using normal saline, but because it's acidic, so I usually add about...
Someone got the music on.
Am I audible? Could I continue?
Yes.
Yeah.
So ringer lactate can also be given safely, but like what I usually ask the patient is how much weight loss has occurred during hemodialysis the day before, and that much amount of fluid can be given safely. If suppose it is 2 kg, then I have to transfuse 2 liters in about half an hour. That's the time the surgeons take for re-anastomosis. So I don't give entire 2 liters of ringer lactate. I give some of balanced crystalloids, some maybe a liter of ringer lactate, and if more fluid needs to be given, then I give normal saline. So it's a mix and match.
So you have drifted towards ringer's lactate. Otherwise, yes. Initially it was a big no-no, and we used to all say, oh no, no ringer's lactate.
No, ringer lactate is the isotonic fluid, so it is in fact safer than normal saline.
Right, right. And another question, Rashmi, you do so much of so many cases of renal transplant, and you get such high risk patients with your ejection fraction might be just 30, and we accept them. I would like to know that in such patients also, would you like to take CVP as high as you had suggested in your lecture, or would you go a little slow on the fluid?
Actually, if I have to balance between keeping the patient hypovolemic and euvolemic, then I would err towards giving fluids, because even if at the time of reperfusion the patient is showing signs of pulmonary edema, then it is still okay if the kidney, the graft function has started, because that fluid can ultimately get eliminated. We can ventilate the patient for some time post-operatively, and so long as the graft is functioning, everything is going to turn around. But if there is no graft function, then we are in trouble. So I would still like to give fluids with right. patients who have marginal myocardium.
Okay, right. Thanks a lot, Rashmi.
Thank you, ma'am.
And one question for Nikunj. Nikunj, like Dr. Rashmi had said that in the Gangaram Hospital, if there was a renal transplant, we did go ahead during the COVID period. I'd just like to know your experience in Medanta. What happened to the electives, elective liver transplants in these last few months?
Yes, ma'am. Initially, we were very scared of doing the liver transplant. But when we came to know this is a no-ending process and how long will go, then we have a certain protocol. So we do 2 COVID tests. Once the patient is admitted, and if it is come negative, then second COVID we do after 7 days. And if it again come negative, then we take this patient. And this holds true for both the donor as well as for the recipient. So 2 samples, consecutive samples, 7 days apart should come negative before taking these patients.
Very true. Because there was always a dilemma that these transplant patients are immunocompromised. So should we really do them in the COVID period? But then over the months, we gradually realized that probably, although they are immunocompromised, but transplant is the choice. So yes. We had to weigh the situation.
You're absolutely right, ma'am. This was a big dilemma initially. But the liver transplant patients are semi-urgent or urgent. We don't absolutely. Let them die like that. So we That's have right. to use some protocol. So we yes. start doing this. And yes, our one patient after the transplant become COVID positive. But luckily, fortunately, after 1 or 1.5 months, it came to be negative also.
Right, right. Great. That's what we were doing for the kidneys also. Great. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Are there any other questions in the question box, Senish?
Yeah, there is one for Nikunj, which somebody is asking about why do you use NORAD and phenylephrine? Is the normally some most people will use NORAD vasopressin and then go on to adrenaline. So basically what he's trying to find out is why do you use phenylephrine? Yeah.
First of all, noradrenaline is no doubt is the choice. And then the second choice is, yes, we also use vasopressin, but it depends patient to patient and individual to individual. Sometimes noradrenaline causes a lot of tachycardia. So we just try to switch over to phenylephrine, and we don't want to switch over to vasopressin. But second choice definitely is vasopressin.
Right. There's one more question over here. How do you prepare yourself for reperfusion? I mean, patient is going to be reperfused. what things you get ready before the you're going to reperfuse? What are your what numbers, etc. you're looking at? I suppose that is what they want to know.
This is for liver transplant reperfusion or renal transplant reperfusion?
No, it's for you.
Okay. So as I told you in my slide also, when we are reperfusing, reperfusion is to be done, we initially, like maybe 5 minutes before, we give mannitol because it acts as osmotic diuresis. Then it has a scavenging action. And one, then we have a syringes loaded with calcium bicarbonate. We have 2 syringes of adrenaline. Then we have elastics with us. And once they unclamp, first they clamp the cava. Once they unclamp the portal vein, there is a sudden fall in pressure. So that time, the adrenaline is the choice. But if suppose we are not able to maintain the hemodynamics, then we give the adrenaline. And to for hyperkalemic fluid, which is flushed out from the graft to the liver, it causes sudden myocardial depression. So calcium carbonate, calcium chloride, we give to for the influx of the potassium ion. And there is a marked acidosis also. For that, we give sodium bicarbonate. And then renal perfusion is also impaired. For that, we usually give Lasix.
Okay. There's one last question for you. Do they always put an IVC clamp, inferior vena cava clamp, or can they do without it? And if yes, when do they do it?
No, now 50% of liver transplant patients are without IVC clamping. They usually put when the anatomy is bad, or especially when there is an inferior veins. Then an osmosis becomes very difficult, then definitely surgeons wants to put a clamp. But there are few conditions, right? Renal, when patient is having a HRS or cardiac compromise or hemodynamic instability is there. So definitely we don't like to put the clamp on the cava.
So can they do without the IVC clamp?
Yes, they do. 50% of the cases are done without IVC, partial clamping. That is known as partial clamping.
Right, that's all I have question on the liver. Let me see if there are any more questions that have come in. Nope. Right, any more for Rashmi?
Vijay, if Rashmi could just elaborate on the sequence of the organs which are harvested for the students, just to know stepwise, Rashmi.
Ma'am, first normally is the cardiac. And hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
First is the cardiac, after that is the liver, and then is the kidneys.
And last is the cornea.
Last is the cornea, yes.
Yes.
Hello. What about the intestines and pancreas and cornea?
Ma'am, cornea is the last. Intestines, we have not done Abhitak in our setup. So maybe I think that should be after the, it should be after the kidneys. Theoretically, I think. But suppose somebody has done it, so they'll be able to tell.
Right. I think that's right. Absolutely right. So are there any more questions in the question box? That's fine, I think. Vijay, those are all, I think.
Yeah, I think that's it.
So with this, we would like to thank all our speakers, Dr. Rashmi Jain, Dr. Nikunj, and Dr. Rashmi Datta, for having, we've had such good lectures. And in fact, even we have learned a lot from your lectures. Thank you so much. And thank you, Dr. Sanish, for this wonderful presentations on the webinar. And we look forward for next Wednesday, as you have already told all of us that next week, Sanish, would you like to elaborate?
Yeah, next week's schedule is already displayed in between. It's from Bangalore. We'll have a lecture on physiology of coronary circulation, anesthetic implications of coronary stents, tetralogy of Fallot for non-cardiac surgery. We have a good set of speakers and moderators and panelists. Do join us on Wednesday, August 12th, 7 to 8:30 again.